There's been widespread praise today for Paul Keating's budget, while the balance of trade figures released today were nearly half the expected deficit, and the stock exchanges and the Australian dollar have taken off.
I think the most encouraging factor is it gave us confidence that the interest rate environment looks very favourable for the immediate future.
Some businesses undoubtedly are going to gain and others lose.
What hopefully will happen, there will be a restored confidence in the property market.
The budget is almost in the black, but the unemployed are still very much in the red.
That was the reaction in words from some quarters today to last night's budget. But if Paul Keating needed other assurances he'd done a reasonable job, he need look no further than the financial market. It turned words into action. The ANZ, Commonwealth, Westpac and National Mutual Royal Banks all cut their mortgage rates by between 0.5% and 0.75% to 14.5%. And the banks say there could be more good news in the not-too-distant future.
Then we would have to be very hopeful we could even look to lowering the rate as the year progresses.
With other banks expected to follow the mortgage reductions, there are now predictions of a boom in housing construction. There were also forecasts that the government's restoration of negative gearing will restore desperately needed stock in the private rental market.
People will convert some of their investment, perhaps from other areas, back into private rental accommodation, and in doing that, hopefully decrease the gap that currently exists between the escalating demand for rental accommodation and the inadequate supply.
The reaction from other sectors of the financial market has been no less stunning. The budget and today's balance of trade figures led to record national trading on stock exchanges, and the Aussie dollar continued to firm. But while the financial markets went into a spin, several of the country's top companies said the budget had been a bit of a non-event for them. They're hanging hopes on Mr. Keating's promised review of company taxation, which is being treated very cautiously.
There is obviously a suggestion that what we might gain on the swings of lower company tax rates, we could lose on the roundabouts of longer tax lives.
The only loud criticism of the budget came from social welfare groups, who welcomed the family assistance package but said the government had done nothing for the unemployed.
Well, if that's good news, I don't know whether it's good news because you don't know who to believe. This may or may not be the good news. The Australia Card Bill passed all stages in the House of Representatives tonight and now goes to the Senate in the next few days for a third time. A bid by the opposition to amend the legislation so it could not be enacted without a referendum was defeated. Health Minister Neil Blewett, who has the best surname in the business, said today referendums have only been held to change the constitution, and to take every controversial issue to the public would mean government by opinion poll. You're quite right, Mr. Blewett, for us to actually express our opinions on important things. Who are we anyway? We stand defeated. Queensland First Class Police Sergeant Col Dillon is continuing to give evidence to the Fitzgerald Inquiry about police attempts to bribe him.
Sergeant Col Dillon has already told the inquiry that when he was attached to the licensing branch between 1982 and 84, he was offered a bribe of $400 a month by former Detective Sergeant Harry Burgess. Today, he said he assumed that Assistant Commissioner Graham Parker would have taken action against certain people named in police intelligence as having formed a group to control organised crime in Brisbane. He said the principals had been identified as Hector Happeter, Anne-Marie Tilley, Vic Conte, the Bellinos, and a person named Feeney. Dillon said the intelligence was gathered by former police officer Nigel Powell, but nothing ever happened. Sergeant Dillon also described an incident which he said occurred at Christmas 1982. He said he opened his locker, in which he kept his service revolver and ammunition, and inside was a bottle of Chivas Regal Scotch whiskey. The next day, he said, Harry Burgess approached him and asked, "Did you get your Christmas present?" Not wanting Burgess to feel threatened, Dillon said he took the scotch but never drank it. He told the commission, "I used to speak to that bottle every night and say, why did I ever bring you home?" Today, he handed the bottle, unopened, back to Commissioner Fitzgerald, who, with a grin on his face, left it sitting on the courtroom bench in front of him for the rest of the morning.
Sergeant Dillon also told the inquiry of visiting a nightclub owned by Hector Happeter, at which he confiscated a briefcase containing a book of names of massage parlours, prostitutes and financial transactions he took to be drug deals. He called on Happeter at home, and later he, Sergeant Dillon, was phoned by the CIB and told to return the briefcase to Happeter. And if you understand that little segment, would you please let us know? We're waiting for your calls. Didn't understand that at all. Doesn't mean anything. I mean, there's more yet to be revealed. The superpowers have ended the first of 3 days of talks in Washington amid speculation that a nuclear arms agreement is imminent. We've heard that song before. But so far, there's no confirmation that a summit meeting will take place.
With growing anticipation of a major arms treaty agreement, the two sides started the 3 days of talks by signing a lesser agreement to reduce the risk of accidental nuclear war by establishing centers in Moscow and Washington, which will inform each other of upcoming tests and exercises.
Foreign Minister, I am pleased to have you sign this agreement today and look forward to the day when General Secretary Gorbachev and I can sign even more historic agreements in our common search for peace.
In the ceremonial photo opportunity, the Soviet foreign minister confirmed he'd given the president a letter from Mikhail Gorbachev, but there was no date set for a summit.
No date, but the summit is necessary.
But any agreement on a summit date will be contingent on these talks ironing out remaining differences over an arms treaty. George Shultz was upbeat about that prospect.
And personally, I think that, at least as I would see them, they're soluble, but that remains to be seen.
The talks resume tomorrow, with White House officials sticking to earlier predictions that while they don't expect a summit date to be fixed this week, they do see the signing of a major arms treaty by year's end. In the United States, Ian Hislop, 7 National News.
Two of Australia's biggest drug runners were sentenced in Sydney's Central Court today. 41-year-old Bruce Cornwall and 44-year-old Barry Bull have been convicted of trying to smuggle a multi-million dollar cargo of cannabis into the country.
Cornwall was sentenced to 23 years and Bull to 18 years for their parts in what's become known as the Rakawa conspiracy. Both pleaded guilty to conspiracy and passport charges after their arrests and extradition from Europe. But during the 8-day hearing, they claimed they were minor figures in the drug ring. The court heard how Bull and Cornwall had arranged for $12 million worth of compressed cannabis to be smuggled into Australia from Thailand aboard the yacht Rakawa 2 years ago. The plot was uncovered by the National Crime Authority from taped telephone conversations. Cornwall and Bull claimed they were minor players in the ring, saying the deal had been organised by an American. Justice Matthews rejected those assertions, saying both were principal participants. In sentencing the pair, Justice Matthews said the financial gains from the drug trade were enormous and the temptations great. She said it was therefore the duty of the courts to deter people by imposing heavy sentences. With remissions, Bull and Cornwall should remain behind bars until the turn of the century. Lawyers for both men are now considering whether to appeal against the severity of the sentences. Norm Lipson, 7 National News.
Yes, actually, I don't think we were tapping a phone then, because the alligator clips were on the microphone end, which merely means you'd be recording what you were saying in the room. Just thought I'd throw that in. Anyway, it's what we call in the business here a vision to cover words. It's so you'll be entertained. New South Wales Premier Barry Unsworth has ordered a new police inquiry into the early release of prisoners. The move comes after claims that not all instances of improper early release have been investigated. The former minister concerned, Rex Jackson, is now serving a 7-year jail sentence for accepting bribes in regard to the early releases. What's next?
Integrate.
We have a break. I think we'll just break. We're going to have a cup of tea back in a couple of minutes. If you're wondering about that phone tapping here, you know, if you saw a tape recorder sort of recording while you're on the phone, you'd tend to be a bit suspicious, wouldn't you? You'd say, oh, is this for anyone or whatever? And little clips would be in the way and that mouthpiece would keep falling out. I think our reenactment here would not win an Emmy. Just a thought. On the subject of communications, Australia's third communications satellite, OSSAT-3, has been launched despite a last-minute hitch when a fuel sensor malfunctioned on board the launcher, a French Ariane rocket fired from French Guiana.
OSSAT-3 is the final link in Australia's national satellite system. After the successful launching of OSSAT 1 and 2, the third satellite was delayed for 12 months after problems with the carrier rocket. But the European Space Agency overcame those design faults, and OSSAT-3 was placed in the Ariane rocket based in French Guiana. Europe's credibility as a space power rested on its successful launch. 6 minutes before liftoff, a fuel sensor stopped the countdown. After a tense 2 hours, technicians rectified the sensor malfunction and the countdown was underway.
Trois, deux, un, top!
Ignition. First stage ignition, liftoff. All the pressures at the combustion chamber normal. Tar cleared. Boosters ignited.
Belrose, here in Sydney's northern suburbs, is the key earth station in the OSAT network. From this antenna comes the orders and guidance for the communications system. Signals beamed through OSAT can reach anywhere in Australia, from the largest cities to the most isolated places in the outback.
It doesn't matter who you are or where you are, it's touching your lives somewhere.
Country centres will be the first to benefit from OSAT. 500,000 Australians in remote areas will soon receive commercial television for the first time. Steve Barnes, Seven National News.
Almost a conflict of terms, isn't it? That all these outback people will last receive commercial television. Imagine the innocence of being out there never having watched me, for example. You'd sleep better at night anyway, wouldn't you? A man banned from owning or breeding dogs in Queensland after one of the state's most notorious animal cruelty cases has now been found operating in New South Wales. Calling himself Brad Alexander, the man sells hunting dogs from his latest kennels in a remote area near Tweed Heads. But Alexander, or Errol Hoggins, to use his real name, values his privacy.
In 1982, Errol Hodgins was convicted of ill-treating animals after police took possession of a truckload of 100 dogs bound for the Northern Territory. Some of the dogs were dead, others were starving. They were taken to Brisbane, where the dogs that could be saved were found new homes. Hodgins was subsequently fined and banned from keeping, breeding or selling dogs in Queensland. RSPCA officials described the case as one of the worst incidents of cruelty to animals on record. Now Hodgins, using the name Brad Alexander, is thumbing his nose at the law by operating his kennel south of the Queensland border. We found more than 60 dogs, ranging from bull terriers to Irish wolfhounds and a breed Hodgins calls a pit Arab. Some were in cramped conditions and uncleaned cages. One lay a metre away, dead for less than 24 hours. When we returned, Hodgins was tending the kennels. He became violent when asked about his Queensland cruelty to animals record.
Get out.
As we attempted to leave, Hodgins became more agitated.
Christ, you've got to hide, you people.
After our visit, New South Wales Police issued Hodgins with a summons to appear in court on charges of keeping unlicensed kennels and not having a dog register.
Looked a bit like Ivan Hutchinson, who does our film report, but it isn't. How dare he hit a television camera crew? And with the Pope visiting America, how dare you, sir? Well, for once, it appears the Premier Kane is actually missing Jeff Kennett. Is it simply because it's spring?
In Parliament yesterday, the Premier went to great pains to highlight Jeff Kennett's absence, referring to him as the Clayton's leader and asking why the opposition leader was on holidays when important business still faced the Parliament. Mr. Kane's comments found their way north to the island holiday location where the Kennett family is staying.
It's believed that when Mr. Kennett was told about the Premier's remarks, he got on the phone and called the Premier from his holiday destination to complain. The Premier apparently defended his remarks, and the phone conversation ended with the two men disagreeing.
The phone protest did little to soften the Premier in Parliament this afternoon.
Did you get on the telephone too?
Order.
He may have got on the phone to Jeff to get other instructions, I don't know.
Parliament goes into recess tomorrow, And while the mud was flying in the lower house, debate was intense in the upper house when the Liberals introduced a private members' bill that would make it illegal for the state government to pass on information to Canberra for the Australia card. So far, the Kane government has remained non-committal on the card, but the bill is designed to force the government to spell out where it stands. Leader of the government in the upper house, Evan Walker, said the ALP would vote against the bill because the ID card legislation had not been passed in Canberra and therefore the situation was hypothetical.
So there. Well, from about now to the end of October, it's breeding time for magpies. So watch out.
It's that time of the year, the marauding magpie month. During the magpie's breeding season, any movement near a nest site can provoke an attack. Every year at Balgala Heights Public School, it's duck and weave, protect yourself or pay the consequences. A scene repeated all over Sydney.
One magpie remedy seriously suggested by the National Parks and Wildlife Service is to wear an ice cream container, appropriately decorated. Looks pretty silly, but it works.
At Currumbina Primary at Lane Cove, the 8 and 9 year olds have made a class project of Maggie-proof headgear. That's a big hat, isn't it? Yeah. Is that for big magpies, is it?
Yeah.
You think it'll work?
Yeah.
Looks like a dragon's hat.
A magpie.
A magpie. Do you think that'll frighten another magpie away?
Probably invite them. Yeah.
With spring in the air, it's a great time to work outdoors, but being a postie is no lark. Col Allison, 7 National News.
Yes, when you don't want to attract birds, you've got a problem. That's Colin Allison. My name's Robertson on 7. After this, I'll be back. Victoria is Australia's first state to try to do something about the greenhouse effect. A conference of appropriate people has opened to avoid the following consequences.
Every cloud may have a silver lining, but these days it's made up of chlorofluorocarbons, carbon dioxide, methane, and other gases spewed into the air by industrialised societies. The pollution has formed a girdle around the earth that lets the sun's heat in, but prevents it escaping, hence the greenhouse effect. The results can and will be disastrous. Within a lifetime, Australia will see major increases or decreases in rainfall, depending on the location. Temperature increases of up to 4 degrees. The southern states will suffer tropical cyclones. Sea levels will continue to rise, engulfing low-lying areas, and natural disasters will become frequent. It's a gloomy picture, but one lightened by the positive steps scientists are now taking to protect our climate and environment. Today, through a far more harmless sort of greenhouse, Conservation Minister Joan Kerner launched the greenhouse project. For the moment, it means more research into the causes and results of the greenhouse effect. Ultimately, it's hoped it will produce a solution.
Therefore, we need to have band-aid approach in a way, in that we need to plan as how we're going to react to it. In the longer term, we have to solve the problem. We have to fix the sore up in a sense, because if we allow it to continue, if we attempt to try and burn all the fossil fuels that are available, then we are in serious global problems.
After all the uproar with local residents in a frenzy and Sir Joe in full flight, RCI has abandoned plans to build a chlorine plant at Lytton in Brisbane's Bayside area. But right to the last, Sir Joe was insisting there was no political disharmony.
Members of the Bayside Action Group were back picketing Parliament this morning despite speculation that ICI had decided to dump plans for its controversial chlorine plant at Lytton. Late this afternoon, the protesters got what they wanted, a statement from ICI admitting that it had abandoned plans for the Lytton plant. The statement said there were indications that the situation would become increasingly acrimonious if the company pursued its plans. It said ICI seeks to have good relationships with the communities surrounding its plants, and it's clear that such a relationship would be difficult to achieve at Lytton. ICI said that an important industrial investment providing increased employment had been lost for emotional reasons unrelated to the true safety of the plant.
Did ICI get you off the hook, Mr. Premier?
No, they didn't get me off the hook. I'm not on a hook. I we made a decision
on the recommendations of Cabinet.
Premier Sir Joe Bjelke-Petersen said his government, and that meant all members of his government, were still 100% behind the Lytton project. Despite reports of growing unrest among backbenchers, some ministers, even party president Sir Robert Sparks, Sir Joe claimed total solidarity on the proposal.
They will be very, very rock solid. They supported completely 100% the attitude that I have adopted and the Cabinet adopted.
As for the victors, they say they don't want to drive ICI out of Queensland. They simply want to see the chlorine plant established somewhere safe.
It's nice that people win occasionally. Next step, the ID. And now the results of the sort of survey that no one believes except the winners. We present it because it's silly. It's only September, but here are the year's most desirable men.
They got together for breakfast at the Opera House. The social set, the high flyers. According to Mode magazine and the Australian Wool Corporation, it's simply not enough to be best dressed anymore.
So we thought now we had to concentrate on their brains as well as their bodies.
Among the top 10, Wimbledon winner Pat Cash, IXL boss John Elliott, owner of the Seven Network, Christopher Skase. And what do they have in common?
High achievers, the people that have achieved the most prominence in the last year.
I've always felt I was a bit wanted at home anyway. I don't know about sharing it with the public.
But this man does.
Given the lack of popularity and acceptance of politicians, I suppose we more than anybody like to be wanted.
And for their latest achievement, a new cool wool coat and a caricature to remind the most wanted 10 they're larger than life. Gina Pickering, 7 National News.
Yes, well, actually, when I saw the introduction of this, talking to my producer a couple of hours ago at the pub, the suggestion was that they are the most desirable, as in a sexual sense. And I surveyed some of the girls downstairs who always call a spade a shovel, and they couldn't find any of them appealing. Although there was one vote for Mr. Elliot's nose. And I think there's a rumour about that, but I don't think you should believe it. It's not true about Ross either. Los Angeles, or the City of Angels, was positively angelic today for the visit of Pope John Paul.
The Pope arrived in Los Angeles to a sign of welcome. Overnight, the Hollywood sign was converted to Hollywood after an L was blackened. 300,000 people lined the streets of LA to see the Pope's motorcade, although organisers predicted at least 1 million would be there. At a cathedral, a spontaneous shout arose before the Pope blessed the congregation. The Pope was appreciative.
I thank you for this blessing.
Meanwhile, at the Colosseum, souvenir stalls did a roaring trade.
For 5 hours before the Pope's arrival at the Colosseum, people were finding their seats at the stadium. Optimistic organisers expected a crowd of 100,000 people at the Mass.
Stringent security delayed admissions, but a capacity audience warmly welcomed John Paul II. The Mass drew the biggest crowd of the Pope's tour. The three-hour liturgy proceeded smoothly, but tomorrow the Pope will urge American bishops to crack down on Catholics defying church teachings. In Los Angeles, Mark O'Brien, 7 National News.
Yes, the Catholic Church in America is not the happiest church in the world. Well, I suppose it's a subjective judgment as to whether people who sing opera make fools of themselves or not. Opera you like or you hate. But if you're in opera, what do you do for kicks, apart from tearing your colleagues to bits in the dressing room? Well, what you do is make a fool of yourself deliberately and occasionally to raise money. And here's proof of the folly, Australian opera performers from their new show, The World Discovery Show.
Argentina knew all the answers, although her relatives and friends were perfect dancers. She swore she'd never dance a step until she died. She said, I've seen too many movies, and all they prove is too idiotic. They all insist that South America's exotic, whereas it couldn't be more boring if it tried. She added firmly that she hated the sound of soft guitars beside a still lagoon. And then she positively stated that she could not abide a southern moon.
She said, I hate to be pedantic, but I'm driven nearly frantic when I see that unromantic, sycophantic lot of sluts forever wriggling their guts. It drives me absolutely nuts. She refused to begin when they requested it. And she made an embarrassing scene if anyone suggested it, for she detested it. Though no one ever could be keener than little Mina on quite a number of very eligible men who did the rumba, when she proposed to them, she simply left them flat. She said that love should be impulsive and not convulsive, and syncopation had a discouraging effect on procreation, and that she'd rather read a book, and that was that. She declined to begin the begin when they besought her to, and with language profane and obscene, she cursed the man who taught her to. She cursed Cole Porter too. From this it's very clear that Nina, in her demeanor, was so offensive that when the hatred of her friends grew too intensive, she thought she'd better beat it while she had the chance. After some trial and tribulation, she reached the station and met a sailor who had acquired a wooden leg in Venezuela, and so she married him because he couldn't dance. There surely never could have been a more irritating girl than Nina. They never speak in Argentina of this degenerate bambina who had the luck to find romance and resolutely wouldn't dance. She wouldn't dance, hola!
Noel Card wrote it. And there were some of the Australian opera in full fright. They'll present more of whatever it is they were just doing at the fourth annual Twilight concert this Sunday at the Sydney Opera House. So be there. I'll be back after this.
She refused to begin the begin when they requested it. And
this next item sounds exciting. It's a further sequel to yesterday's apparently dazzling budget. The Prime Minister says he was in Sydney tonight, relaxed, charming and in good form, speaking to Australian business leaders at the annual, and are you sorry you missed this, the annual Australian Financial Review post-budget dinner.
In Sydney tonight, Prime Minister Bob Hawke basked in the glory of Australia's first balanced budget in 17 years.
In summarising the budget, ladies and gentlemen, I would say we have delivered. We have delivered in full measure on our election commitments.
Australians were the winners, he said in the Australian Financial Review post-budget address, through lower inflation, lower interest rates and more jobs. But then the hard sell. No government which had struggled so hard with the budget deficit could afford to ignore the Australia card.
Now, I certainly do not underestimate the material benefits of the card. Nearly $1 billion in extra revenue will substantially improve the government's ability to provide better services to the whole community.
The card was a necessary tool in the fight against tax evasion and welfare fraud. It was blatant nonsense to refer to it as totalitarian or authoritarian.
It would be a serious offence for police to require production of the card. You did not recognise that sophisticated security software will be in place to prevent unauthorised access to the card register, and that no other computers will be linked to the register.
It's really hard to be convinced. All the police stations, or the central police in each city, have details of your offences. And I know some policemen, and I said, one day, would you do a little printout, please? And I found that I'd been fined three or four times, when in fact I had never been fined at all. I just thought I'd throw that in. Had I not questioned it, they would have said, this man's a lunatic, this one. The system's a lunatic. Actually, it was once they said I had sped, went fast. Just thought I'd throw that in. There's no software that can't be cracked because some little loony there will tell his mates how to get into it. Not convinced. will not be voting next time, Mr. Hawke. A New York man has solved his labour difficulties by the usual device of employing people to do his work for him. The twist is the man is a well-known painter of pictures.
These are paintings by Mark Kostabi, a rising or at least twinkling star in the art world, but you don't see any paint on Mark Kostabi's hands. Even as he plays the piano, another of his paintings is taking shape in the next room. Someone else is applying the paint, and there's a good chance this woman conceived the idea. But when it's finished, this canvas will be called a Kostabi, and it will sell for as much as $10,000.
And most successful artists, it's obvious that they have assistants executing their work, but they always downplay it. And I say, you know, why downplay it? Why not only admit that you have people doing the work for you, but take it a step further and hire someone to think up the ideas.
Kostabi's trademark is the faceless, sometimes headless figure. He used to paint them himself, but then he decided he could produce more with a little help. So he advertised for assistance. Inventive artist wanted to provide ideas for Mark Kostabi. Diana Gentleman answered the ad and gets paid $8 an hour to sketch ideas.
There are ideas of mine, and they're drawn in a style that Mark can use.
And sell. Ron Feldman is the gallery owner who represents Mark Kostabi.
That he recognizes talent in others. And so he has hired, advertised, and then hired an incredibly talented staff, and they're much more talented than he is.
It's a fabulous painting. This is completely conceived of by Diana and executed by Claude.
But it will sell as a Kostabi. Curator Patterson Sims of the Whitney Museum compares Kostabi's technique to what designers like Perry Ellis do with sheets.
They're not sitting down and designing each line and each tuck and each fold of those sheets. What they are doing is imprinting their sensibility in those sheets.
Some collectors have expressed concern about whether they've purchased genuine Kostabis, while others seem eager to own his more, shall we say, collaborative works.
What part of a Kostabi is Kostabi's?
Well, all of it is his and none of it is his at this particular point.
In time, I have a suspicion that he is a second-rate artist.
It doesn't matter whose work it is, and as long as it gets done and as long as it's great.
But it's called a Kostabi.
Yeah, I don't mind.
In today's art world, the name is the game, regardless of who painted what eventually gets framed.
He doesn't mind. It's quite flexible, isn't he? Of course, what they should do is merely change the name at the bottom, so it's no longer a Kostabi. Who cares, anyway? People I work with haven't got places big enough to put a painting on the wall, although our bosses have, but that's another story. A North Californian couple are the owners of the largest private railway in the world. That is a toy railway system.
Each season when the wheat is harvested and the beans are picked, Betty and Godfrey are busy with their hobby. They work side by side down in their basement for the past 35 years.
Poems are made by fools like me, but only God can make a tree. Well, see, I'm trying to make a tree.
Betty contributes to the landscape. Godfrey builds the locomotives. Together, they've created the largest private railroad in the world.
Some of the locomotives have taken better than 300 hours to build. And the trees, most of them are hand-built. There's some 800 people in here and over 1,000 trees.
Number 12, leaving Gerber northbound.
Okay.
All the buildings are built from scratch with using Southern Pacific plans. And the trains are run on schedule, on a time schedule, and we have a number of meets that we have to make within seconds.
We're coming to Anderson. Gonna blow the whistle now.
Yeah. Let them know we're coming.
In 35 years, he's acquired 16 engines and managed to build the track that's 840 feet long. That's about as long as 3 football fields. Betty and Godfrey's model railroad layout is a replica of Northern California, complete with their hometowns, the places they worked, the spot they fell in love and got married.
Boy, look at that pretty scene over there.
But for even longer than he's loved Betty, Godfrey's had a romance with trains. Fortunately, Betty has never been the jealous type.
I like him.
She's allowed her husband to have 2 romances.
Well, how's that figure? Which romance are you in love with most?
Sometimes I wonder.
It's nice, isn't it? Betty and Godfrey. They were probably young once. many, many years ago, then he discovered trains. More after this. The inquest into the deaths of six people in a plane crash near Essendon Airport last September has been told there seemed no reason for the aircraft's engines to fail.
When the left engine of the Cessna 402 air ambulance failed just after takeoff from Essendon Airport on September 3rd, pilot Bill Sir had only seconds to act. The plane, with a nurse and four patients on board, had reached a height of about 30 metres and was dangerously close to power lines. Air safety investigator Colin Geraghty, who was in charge of the crash inspection, told the inquest today the pilot radioed the control tower that he was going to head straight and feather the engine to try to glide safely to the ground. But he couldn't shut down power and make a radio call at the same time, as he had to operate a handheld microphone. The court also heard evidence from airworthiness surveyor John Guscott, who said investigators couldn't find any reason why the plane's left engine failed after takeoff. Mr. Guscott said there was nothing to suggest it was faulty and said the only possible explanation was that an oversupply of fuel had flooded the engine. He added that neither of the propellers had been feathered before the plane hit the ground. The inquest continues tomorrow.
Now I have a book here that was stolen by my producer from me. He knows I enjoy photography, so he likes to get back at me occasionally because he can't on air. It's called Country Life in Old Australia. It's a book from publishers Viking O'Neill. That should assure him of the next collection. A collection of photos from the last century, nearly all of them new, that is to say, not the usual clichés in the streets we all recognise, but photos from state and private collections not seen before. The text is done by Geoffrey Dutton. These are some of the pictures. To think there were more elegant times, perhaps they were. Simpler, certainly, but a lot harder. Country life in old Australia. Wouldn't mind visiting that if I could go back in time, just for a couple of days. After this, the weather. You'll have to help me here because I'm not into tennis. There's some names here I don't know. I'll spell the ones I'm not too sure of. Adelaide's Mark Woodford has been left out of Australia's Davis Cup squad for the semi-final against India next month. He's furious. Woodford was the only Australian to reach the last 16 at the US Open. Simon Youl and Darren Cahill were preferred to Woodrow. Woodrow. Ah, dear, he died, didn't he? Were preferred to Woodford. They joined Peter Doohan, Wally Masur, I'm sure this is an anagram, and John Fitzgerald and Pat Cash hit a six-man squad.
Simon Youl is believed to be the first Tasmanian to be selected in an Australian Davis Cup squad. Once the second-best junior in the world, he's been plagued by injuries in recent years and is now seen to be fulfilling that early potential. 21-year-old Cahill is currently ranked 113th in the world. He survived the qualifying rounds of the US Open before bowing out in the second round.
I was hoping, you know, it's something I've always hoped for, to get in the squad. It's a little step for me, and hopefully I can consolidate that spot and just keep playing well.
Neither is expected to gain a Guernsey in the team which takes on India in Sydney early next month, but Captain Neil Fraser sees the selection as an investment in the future.
I think they realise they've got a hard row to hoe, but they're making it, and I'm quite sure that it won't be too long down the track before they do play.
One man who's assured of a spot is Wimbledon champ Pat Cash. Still in hiding in Queensland after his first round exit from the Open, Fraser believes the shock loss may work in his favour.
Maybe it's a blessing in disguise. He's had that extra 2 weeks off and have a good clean break from tennis and come back very, very fresh for the Davis Cup.
I think he'd get up for the interview, wouldn't he? We're actually thinking that Woodrow and a little two pairs of Reeboks wouldn't look too bad on the court. Not necessarily in his present condition, but it's tennis for you. Now, the weather, the current temperature on our teletext is 15, Brisbane is 17, and 12 in Melbourne. And around the state today, a summary of the weather, if I can use the word summary, Weipa 34, the maximum in Queensland, Stanthorpe the minimum at 3, Brisbane 12 to 24, Casino, Thredbo and Sydney, City 10 to 21, Mildura had the maximum for Victoria, 21, Mount Buller, 0. And Melbourne, 10.7 to 17.1. Quilpie, the only place in Queensland to receive rain, though it will change tomorrow, 0.9. Mount Buller in Victoria, 1, Colac, 1. New South Wales devoid of the moist stuff. This is the synoptic chart. What isn't shown here is an upper level low here, which is producing some rain in southeastern Queensland, and the odd onshore wind, which is producing some coastal rain. This front down here is moving fairly quickly. It's going to be only going to affect the coast, as far as the pundits have said. And the winds are coming from the west now. So they've stopped coming from the south. They're bored with that. Same old white stuff. And this high pressure system will mean better conditions coming ahead. But in all, it's not so bad. So the weather for tomorrow, anyway, for Brisbane. Thursday, a few showers and a thunderstorm from that high-pressure low, 14 to 25. This is the Skase family. Pictures of their last Christmas get-together. Lovely, just released. He sent down, would you please put them into the weather? He said, certainly, not knowing what it is, but he's boss. Lovely. Grandfather Skase. Skase in point. Thursday will be fine, 11 to 21 for Sydney. Friday, fine. Saturday, fine. And Sunday, not so fine. I think we've got the wrong ones back from the chemist here. We can't work out who these people are. Melbourne. Have I done Melbourne? Fine. Windy, late chains and Sunday showers. And so interstate. Oh, dear. It'll be fine. Adelaide, 8 to 19. Now, this is gorgeous. You know, all right for you anorexic. Look at this. Look. Just marvellous. Just makes you feel good, doesn't it? Good to feel good to be a male. Back tomorrow.